It's all fun and games till someone gets shot.
I don't know how to say this. Like, it's, I feel like I live in a constant state of like criticism where I do something to entertain people and then there's always negativity that comes back. So it's like you put something out, negativity comes back.
Welcome back to the channel, everyone. Today I have three more news articles to talk about. If you guys are subscribed to the channel, you guys would have seen that I'm kind of doing this thing on the channel right now where I went back to the past 6, 7, 8 years ago, and I found these news articles, things Harada has said and done, and I'm just seeing how it sort of evolved over time. What he changed, what he didn't change, what he stuck to, what he didn't stick to. I think it's very interesting. Tekken 7 has been here for literally 7, 8 years, depending on how you look at it, and it's very interesting. So much has changed. And sometimes we don't really even know how much has changed. For example, let's see if you guys, I want to test your knowledge real quick. Let's test your knowledge. Did you know that Katarina, her name was initially Catalina? Did you know that? It says new character Catalina announced for Tekken 7. And they have a picture here. Now, I've seen this screenshot before, but at the bottom of it, you could see Catalina revealed number one. And it's just things like that that I found very fascinating when I went back. One of the main topics that I want to talk about today is Harada's past perception of frame data. And I think I figured out why. This news article helped me get insight as to why we pay for frame data. It says, Harada says revealing Tekken frame data is possible, but he wouldn't want to do it. Feels doing so will impact the game's lifespan. A few quotes from him. The first one says, it is of course possible to display the frame data within the game, but I wouldn't do it. Including the entire frame data into the game, there are things to consider when you give the players access to this. It says, if players could easily have access to such data within the game, it will allow players to uncover and find out intercars, I don't know what that is, and details about characters and their moveset much faster, which can lead to an impact on the game's lifespan. This is fascinating. If people have access to frame data, they will learn the game's secret faster, and as such, the game will no longer be a mystery. Now, of course, everyone disagrees with this. That goes without saying. But I think just the logic there doesn't really make sense. I kind of use the same logic for people who don't want backdashing to be easier, who don't want grappling to be, change, right? Wanting the game to be harder because you feel like it makes the game better, it doesn't. You do have to give some wiggle room so that more people can get into these higher levels, right? Why would someone spend all this time trying to learn some meaningless things? I want to know how fast my character swings, so I need to go online to some random website. I'll probably get a virus. What? No, just put it in the game so people can actually learn. They can actually progress. Now, the reason why I think they made it to where you have to pay for it, of course, Harada said, oh, we put a lot of effort into this, so that's why we're charging. But I think charging is another way of making it to where people don't know, right? In a way, when you put that paywall, you are preventing a lot of people from experiencing this. So I think, and that's the thing, a lot of new players to the game may not even know what frame data is. They may not understand what frame data does, how it helps you. So I think them putting that paywall there is kind of doing what Harada wants. It's like preventing people from learning the game's secrets. Because that's the thing, you have to, in order to pay for frame data, you have to know what frame data is. You have to know the value in that. It's easy to look at a character and it'd be like, oh, this character looks cool. Oh, this character looks cool. But when you see frame data, if you aren't a diehard Tekken player, you're gonna be like, what is this? What value is this to me? That's why I think they did it. But let's move on. Now I wanna talk about the very first hacker. Now, Tekken 7 has a lot of hackers. It has a big cheating problem. But if we go back to Tekken Revolution, when the first hacker showed itself and was revealed by Bandai Namco, it says, user hacked Tekken Revolution to give himself max stats, resulting in one-hit kills and seemingly unlimited health. Harada says he'll be banned. This is just so hilarious. Back in Tekken Revolution, when hacking and cheating was very small, this is the thing. If you go back to Tekken Tag Tournament 2, that game did not have all these problems like Tekken 7. And you really wonder why Tekken 7 is the way that it is. If Tekken Tag Tournament 2 has good netcode, doesn't have a massive cheating problem, doesn't have a massive hacking problem, why does Tekken 7 suffer all these things? I think it's just so funny how in Tekken Revolution, they found this one guy and they was like, yeah, we're going to ban him. We're going to show him to cheat in our game. And then you skip over to the next game and now everyone's doing it. Cheating is such a big problem to where no one can escape it. It really is funny just to see how this escalated. They thought they were stopping it, but really it was just the beginning, right? It was just the beginning, and it's funny. The next one, I want to move on to this one because this one is very fascinating. In the beginning of Tekken 7, Jin was kind of, I guess they were teasing the fact that Jin possibly would have died in Tekken 6. He wasn't going to be in Tekken 7. It says, is Jin really not being considered for Tekken 7 because he died in Tekken 6? Harada responds to fan rumor. And I guess this all sort of started with a fake tweet. Someone created a fake tweet of Harada and it says, Jin died in Tekken 6, so we're not considering him for Tekken 7. That sounds legitimate. That sounds like something Harada would say, but it's fake. I just think this is so fascinating to think about. If Jin actually died in Tekken 6, what would that mean for Tekken? Of course, you would still have Kazuya versus Heihachi fight, but then you would just have Kazuya being alive at the end. Heihachi would be dead, Jin would be dead, and it would only be Kazuya left. And that would be, I think that is an interesting storyline to discuss as well. What would it look like if Kazuya was the last one alive? Also, what would it look like if Jin was the last one alive? I think those are two very good stories that can be told, right? How the other characters would react to both of these different people surviving. And not only surviving, but having the power, the control. But Harada responds, he says, I'll say it. Google it. That's all. And this wasn't a response to someone saying, someone made this and it's making people angry. And it's basically just a screenshot of the tweet. Heck of funny that he put, and it's making people angry. It's like, nowadays when you talk about Tekken, people get upset about everything. People get upset that I don't show Tekken footage. People get upset that I don't talk about, that I talk about the story. People get upset. Like, that's the thing. People get upset about everything. In conclusion, of course, Jin is alive. A lot of people are very exciting, including myself, to see what happens in Tekken 8. I think if I had to put my money, place a bet, I would say Jin is going to kill Kazuya. It's the way the story is set up, Jin is the good guy. So that's expected. That's the expected path for them to take, is Jin killing Kazuya. And honestly, I think since it's so expected, I think it's better that they choose another path. They give us a curveball, something we're not expecting. Maybe Jin can save Kazuya from the dark side, right? In Tekken 8, what they should do to help out new players, right? If someone buys Tekken 7 and they've been playing for 1 month and then Tekken 8 comes out, to help that new player, they should, instead of that new player having to go into practice mode and practicing backdashing for 3 years in order to be able to do it in a match, I was suggesting that they should just make the backdash recover faster. When you press back, that should either recover faster or it should just take a bigger step back. Now, what I also said is you can still have in the Korean backdash, and that could be the more advanced version, right? You have the normal backing up, which is kind of, it's kind of okay, right? You can escape some mid, some short range attacks, right? But then you also have the advanced Korean backdash where you can just escape everything. That is what I was saying. But people don't like that. They don't like a second way to move being introduced into the game. People who's been playing the game for a very long time and their followers want you, the only way that you can move around in the game is to Korean backdash. And me personally, I don't understand it. I don't understand why people are so afraid of a new way of moving being introduced into the game, right? I'm not saying get rid of Korean backdash. I'm not saying make it obsolete. I'm just saying for new players, they should be able to, this is the thing, you shouldn't have to practice for 3, 4, 5 years in order to do the Korean backdash just to go defense, right? I'm going to read this comment and then I'm going to continue. It says, I disagree. We definitely do not want to make the game easier. The higher skill ceiling is what keeps these 20-year-old pros around and what makes the game so addictive. So that first part right there. Who cares about these 20-year-old pros? Why is people so afraid of the pros who've been around for 20 years having to deal with a new type of backdash, right? This is the thing. I know this is what Nisei and this is what Mainman Sweet, the higher skill ceiling is what keeps these 20-year-old pros around. People who's been playing the game for 20 years, they will continue to play the games for 20 more years, right? When Tekken Tag Tournament 2 was the main game in the franchise, before Tekken 7, before Tekken Revolution, just Tekken Tag Tournament 2, that game was a mess. But you know who was still playing it? The 20-year-old veterans. That's the only people was playing it. And think about that. That game sucked. That game, Tekken Tag Tournament 2, almost killed the franchise. That game literally was the worst thing that happened to Tekken ever. And the pros like Nee, JDCR, Mainman, all these pros still played it. Tekken 7. Here comes Tekken 7. This game is sort of made so it could be more easier, more accessible. And you know who still is playing it? The pros. So my point is, regardless of what they do, Nee will still play it. Mainman Sweet will still play it. All of these people, K-Swiss, Lil Majin, they're all still going to play it. But, you know who is not going to play the game if it is made super try-hard, if it's made super competitive, if it's made so hard to where you have to spend 5 years to do anything? You know who's not going to play it? 7 million people. This game has sold 7 million copies, and it has not done that by making the game harder. It's done that by making the game easier. I am very against making the game easier in certain aspects. I like them making it easier so new people can get into the game. What I don't like is them making it easier so a new player can compete with someone like me who's been playing for 11 years. I don't think they should make the game that simple, that easy to where someone can compete with me who hasn't put in the same time. I understand what they're saying in this comment, but the thing is, in fighting, there is offense and there is defense. In Tekken 7, it takes zero effort to be a aggressive, offensive fighter. But in order to go on defense, you have to practice for 7 years in order to master the Korean backdash. All I'm saying is they should make it to where it's easier to back up. This game is so aggressive. All these characters have extreme frame traps, okies, setups, frame traps, unblockables, all these crazy things. And I think you should just be able to back up. Why are people so against that? Why are people so trying to protect people like Nee? Nee is one of the best Tekken players of all time, and he will continue to be. No matter if they add in whatever crazy mechanic, Nee will still be the best regardless. Just because these pros who are the best, literally 1% of players are high level. Everyone else is not high level. Even myself, you know, I am blue ranks, and I say all the time that that blue rank means nothing. I just think that grabs, I still believe grabs should be punishable. If someone tries to rolling death cradle you, giant swing, a chain throw, a throw that wall splats, a throw that has guaranteed follow-ups, a throw that has some crazy okey, I think these things should be punishable. I don't care how easy it is for me to defend against it. It's like, what about the 7 million other players who die to these things? 7 million other players will get landslided by a grab. It's like, I don't know. I know I am alone in this thinking, and I don't really care. I just think that it's kind of absurd how far people go to defend high-level gameplay. And most of these people are not high-level gameplay themselves. You're just not. That's all I really have to say about it. I just don't understand, you know, why people are so... it's like they're afraid of change. But that is it. That's all I have to say. Hopefully you guys enjoyed this video. I know some of you guys probably won't, but that's fine. That's it. Thanks for watching. See you later. Bye-bye.